if it's in your heads, not mine. So we want to have more participation and maybe have a minute or two at the beginning now on ways that we might engage you to participate a little more. There are examples at the back of the syllabus. Many of these are for a larger scale project, like a paper, a full 20-page course paper, or part of a BA or an MA or PhD. Most of you are not doing that. Most of you are just going to do the exams, and that's fine. But we want to have ways that if you're only doing the exams, you can still do a little bit. So one small thing, maybe not articulated there, two small things, are first, we're going to ask for volunteers maybe Wednesday or so to, for instance, one thing could be to comment on the readings and to raise questions so we have some discussion extending the readings, and any of you could do that in any of the areas. So you could volunteer to, if there's a particular section, a particular set of themes that you'd like to lead some discussion on, and maybe you have questions you don't know what the answer is, and maybe I'll say I have no idea, but at least talking about it is something which can be useful, in the sense that the point is, in the future, we don't know what the questions are, we don't know what the answers are, but looking at ways of going through the process of systematically using concepts and approaches that we've developed here in part to help you try to use them is one thing we want to try to work through together with some concrete examples. And there are lots of past student papers, some online, some that we can talk about. We may bring in a person or two, but that in turn depends on what your engagement. So, okay, so option one, discuss a little bit in the readings with some questions linked to that. Second, if you're planning on doing a paper, and a couple of you are doing that, or considering doing that, a MAPS MA, for instance, that's a bigger commitment than most of you in the college are making, but having those of you who are a little further along talk about your MA problems, what you might do, what, you know, how it may link to the course or not, that would be great. So two of you are nodding heads. Anybody else working on it, let's say a BA, MA possible paper, or a little outside research, such as Kelton is working on Trump, for instance, and he's struggling. We're struggling together, you know, how to interpret Trump. And so we've got, Dan Silver and I had about 60 pages of memos. Then we got, I think, five guys. They're all political science majors, third, fourth year, smart. They're taking all kinds of political science courses. We're trying to put this together, and we're meeting week by week trying to have something clear, original, interesting to say. I mean, so that's another example that we can talk about. Is there anyone else who's doing or thinking about a paper that might be a candidate for something like this? Yes?
Yeah, I put in a paper proposal to look at Oakland, California as a case study.
Okay, fantastic. Yeah. Fantastic. Any particular theme within Oakland?
Well, one of the themes that I'm looking at is the impact of gentrification driven by the second wave of the dot-com boom. There's been a lot of discussion about Oakland being termed San Francisco East, Brooklyn West, which I have some serious issues with.
Sure.
But I wanted to kind of look at issues of displacement, certainly tying in themes around scenes, given, you know, Oakland's bohemian past and its evolution as a diverse community that was a real haven, and how that, what the future might look like given those threads in its history. So.
Fantastic. That sounds like a great topic for us, for you and for a session, so let's maybe look for a couple of themes later on in the course that we can link. But that one of them is basically case studies of taking individual cities, and Oakland could be one here, as we do in the other readings on Austin, on Chicago, and Milwaukee, and so forth. okay, so those are two kinds of approaches. Discussing books, talking about research that you're doing. The third could be something like a mini project, not a full paper, not something big, but for instance, interviewing three people and maybe videoing them and asking them, how did the something or other, how is this process of gentrification in Oakland being confronted in your neighborhood if you interviewed three people? But then try to get three very different answers and then somehow put them together. So, I mean, for instance, most of you are in Chicago. You could potentially interview people over Skype and even have a video of that. If you use QuickTime Player, you can video, if most of you have Macs, if you use QuickTime Player, you can click on, what's it called, movie recording or new movie. Go to file, new movie, and you can video a Skype session or another session online like that, and then have something you can show Antoine. I mean, Antoine is our tech senior director here of how these things can be put together, and that could be something you could show us a little of, talk a little bit about, and build on it, and even use in an MA. Okay, so think of a possible video snapshot of something, but to make it more creative, you can't just talk to three random people. You've got to think through how do the bigger questions, such as why, how do the processes of gentrification lead to this versus that and so forth, how can I get that to come out with the questions I ask in a more subtle way, etc. Let me pause for a minute and ask if anyone else, you the students, our two teaching assistants, have other possible suggestions of small, simpler kinds of things that we might do that would enhance discussion and participation by you in this second half of the course. Folks, anybody have a suggestion or something that you're thinking about that you've seen done in another class, or you thought about, or you haven't seen in any class, but you'd really like to try out, for instance?
One thing that comes to mind is one of the topics we've talked about is Trump, and we have folks looking at that. But in terms of the implications for some of the actions that are being taken and how they speak to the theory that we've been working on, I'm particularly interested in the impact of the executive orders on governance more generally and what messaging is being sent out. And I mean, it remains to be seen, but what does that mean, not just in a federal national context, but state level and down from there in terms of culture shifts and different orientations and how folks are also agitating against that or for that, because you have different, opposing opinions. So that's something that I think would be really interesting in terms of kind of honing in on making that tie into theory.
That sounds perfect again. And a lot of people I know have even said, have volunteered. We've been talking a lot about these issues in ways that I haven't been keeping up with the course reading. That is, let's join the two and try to make sense, dig a little deeper behind just the front page headlines and say, how can we make sense of this? And you articulated just perfectly. Yeah.
In terms of format, it can be complicated or really easy, but I've been thinking about podcasting in particular in these conversations, because The Nation produced a really good one called The United States of Anxiety that's like deep ethnographic interviews with Trump supporters leading up to the election that sheds new light on it in a way better than anything else that I've read. And their follow-up is called There Goes the Neighborhood, which they produced with WNYC that's like a serial investigation of processes of gentrification and the battles in Brooklyn. And so that's one example where you can explore scenes through audio. But these types of conversations are like being synthesized in interesting ways. Podcasts are inherently digestible. So like recording a podcast episode or just like reporting on ones that are super relevant might be a way to dig into the themes of the class.
Sounds great. Kelton, yeah.
One thing I've been thinking about is like specifically with regards to scenes and Trump is the different scenes. I don't know if you would describe it as scenes, but the different cultures we're seeing revolving around like protests and the anti-protests we see, and the scenes that are being created within these little conglomerates of people that care about certain issues. So like on one end we see people walking for the Women's March, on another end we see people chanting like build that wall. And I think it's kind of creating this dichotomy of like two separate spheres of Trump and anti-Trump scenes revolving around certain different issues. And some people protest for some things and some people protest for others, but you definitely feel like a scene's environment when you're at a protest or when you see those things on the news.
Okay, and that's good. An elaboration that could be to start with the sort of the news coverage, which tends to usually feature, or let's say disproportionately feature, protest, confrontation, outliers, very strong cases. And then maybe get some kind of national or let's say perspective on this and see, in a sense, and one theme that we're pursuing with the Trump supporters is there are many, many different types of Trump supporters and scenes where Trump may be favorably or unfavorably viewed. And rather than saying there, here's the explanation for Trump, there are lots of different things going on. And to get to try to capture some of that richness without being purely, you know, every person is different, every neighborhood is different, trying to get some of the major types is one thing that we're trying to do. So in a sense, starting with the protest, but then seeing what and how, in a sense, it's like starting with the vote. Here's the vote, but why the vote? And so the simplest example with reply is the so-called the post-election surveys where people are asked quick questions. Then you have percentage of women, percentage of highly educated people, et cetera, who voted for Trump. But that doesn't get into the whys as well as we might. Other suggestion?
I was thinking maybe we could have like a different way of grounding our participation and discussion around contemporary issue would be to like if people in the class volunteer to look over certain publications, like we would have a Washington Post correspondent in the class, and
we'd have what in class?
A Washington Post correspondent, like someone who's just
Washington Post correspondent, okay.
From one publication, another person who's responsible from basically going over the news in another one, because you said that we should go beyond the headlines. So that could be one way of, I mean, it wouldn't take so much effort, I guess, because everyone, I think, is more or less doing that in their own time. So that could be one way.
Okay, great. Yeah, so to look at the headlines and then what they're and maybe even why they're leaving things out. They may be promoting, showing more violence because people get excited and it may be seen as stimulating more emotion, or some things may be considered too complicated. And in contrast to this audience, the general media are dumbing down. And so we're trying to bring it. So one way I've illustrated that is to say life is multi-causal, and the media tend to give you a one cause, one story kind of format. Wall Street Journal, New York Times, almost two-thirds of the stories are one story. And story means here's a factor, an extreme, it's a one case, often one factor of why people voted for Trump, because the furniture factory closed in their town, therefore they voted for Trump. So that's a classic story in the news media. And so sort of starting with that trope and then saying, how could that be embellished by social science? Or if you're working in a law firm, or you're the assistant to a mayor, or you're working as an investment advisor, how can you bring in more subtlety that would match with people in these areas where you're, I mean, right now, if you're working, I mean, if, you know, you're likely to be working after college. If you go right to work with a BA, or you work for a few years with a BA and then you go on to other degrees, you're likely to be working with higher level people than the media are aiming toward. And they want and they expect from you, if you're going to rise and do well, more subtlety. They want something from the USC if they're going to hire you. So how can you bring them something that will maybe show them, say, here's what people have normally done, and here's how and why we're going to do it better. So you can. So it's not that you totally ignore the old Oakland or the simple gentrification story, the old left-right, but say, here's how we start with the old left-right, and here's how we add more pieces and get to something else. Okay. All right, those are all, yeah.
I was thinking maybe we could also look at this Twitter account, Trump Regrets. It is a compilation of all people who have voted for Trump are dissatisfied with Trump. And I think it could be a good way of looking at what doesn't work in the type of leadership that Trump proposes.
Okay. Good. I would say let's also, as you've heard me comment once more than once, let's try to be quite explicit about the sort of ideological, I'm right and he's wrong or he made a mistake. But yes, we don't want to ignore that, but we want to, that is the application of a party program or of a moralistic right or wrong to actions linked with, not totally apart from, but linked with social science concepts such as Weber's introduction of multi-causality, of status as well as class, of putting things together in ways that that give them more explanatory power. And then of course the key concepts that we're confronting here. So let's try to always be conscious and sometimes explicit about here's the ideological take, here's an interpretive take, which may start with journalistic interpretation and grow into more sophisticated social science in ways that can enhance the general public or general journalistic reactions. Okay. All right. Let me push on with what we have in the course now, and the linkage from what I've just said with this section of the course is it's called Transformations, and it tries to give us some ways of being more explicit, self-conscious about when things change, how do you change your interpretation? How do things get sharper, clearer, more wise, perhaps? And we go through several examples of this. and I will use them because they're written up, they build with very important people like Aaron Vildavsky. But we want to try to use them as examples that we can use again in the future of trying to say, how can the theory we had in the past be adapted? So most of these, So we have a little bit on Vildavsky. Then we have a little bit on the book City Money shows how to look for historic periods where one set of things may work, and then all of a sudden along comes a new set of events, and bang, they don't work anymore, they change. And that's exactly what we're talking about in this Trump, Brexit, populist, immigration, confrontation right now. That is, and so rather than saying, all social science is lost, we try to say, for instance, as we do in the global local politics course, if we add changes in the immigration patterns what does that change in terms of how X leads to Y leads to Z? What are the logical or at least plausible linkages, and then how might we test them? And again, I'll throw out that it's reasonable to do it in discussion or in a paper to say, no, we don't have the evidence right now, we don't have the tools and the analysis, but let's pretend we had $10 million, and what data would we collect and what analyses would we do of those data if we had everything we wanted? And thinking that through logically, you may be working in a place where you'll have $10 million and they'll say, this is so important, we better find this out. If you're working for Google, you're working for the CIA, you're working for NBC, they're spending $10 million all the time. Okay. Or they're doing much bigger, more complicated, expensive things than the cost of that. All right. The heading of the section is called Transformations in the Urban Context, the End of Government Growth, Cuts in Intergovernmental Grants, Breakup of Class Politics, and the Classic Left and Right. Start briefly with Aaron Beldofsky. I mentioned already briefly that he developed in his first half of his career what an approach called incrementalism. That increments were chunks of history, and last year was an increment, and the next year is another increment, and the next year is another increment. So the increment of theory basically says that t minus 1 leads to t plus 1. And the implicit idea is that they're all sort of pretty much slight variations of the same thing. Beldofsky pursued this in case studies in Oakland, in the US government, in a book called Incrementalism. It was called Implementation into Oakland, in following this kind of approach. Then came 19, he lived through 68, and that was part of it, but the combination of 1968 with 1978 was Proposition 13 in California. The combination of those led him to totally change his intellectual perspective. So I'm saying that is, this was much bigger than what I'm suggesting you may want to be able to do in thinking what do we do at post-Trump, post-immigration, et cetera, et cetera. That is, you can either change or revise your analytical framework, or you can put together past things so they can go further and see further than what you did before. So when in the second half of his career, he was still an eminent political scientist, he was still a professor at Berkeley, he was still writing about the same kinds of themes: how do decisions get made, who supports them, what do the parties do, what do the interest groups do, etc. But he put them together in a different way. And he didn't throw out completely what he had done, but he basically said, and many people do this as well, they say, well, I wasn't really wrong, but instead of looking at, say, all these types, I was really looking at this and this, and now that I realize these other things might be going on, that can give me a framework for saying, what might happen in China if we have this change and that change? And if this is important for Western Europe and the US, this is much more important for China, which is going through tumultuous changes. Much bigger, much faster, huge variations. the concept of hierarchy and class is a PhD topic. And if you take it directly from Marx in 19th century, it could be, say, proletarian versus bourgeois. Could be the cleavage, the rich versus the poor. But as we've heard, the labels they use in China today are new middle class and old middle class. Those were not in Marx. Where do these come from, and what meaning do they have in places where they were originally used and where they're used in China, and how much do these help us understand different neighborhoods, different groups in China today, for instance? And or how much might those two labels be clarified further? So for instance, when Lloyd Warner introduced classes and revised classes, he talked about upper, middle, and lower. This is the 1930s, 1940s. He then had upper, lower upper middle, lower middle, upper, lower. I mean, so he had six types of classes. And then for instance, and he studied them in detail in himself in Newburyport, Massachusetts, in a famous book called Yankee City. But he then went on and worked with others here in another book called Black Metropolis on Bronzeville, South Side. Another book on the Midwestern small town, sort of WASPy, newly settled WASPy style in Indiana. And then a book in the South, the American South. And the national contrasts of these, he then built on and pulled together in multiple volumes, which show that that's Warner. There was an American anthropologist, Chicago anthropologist, who decided he wanted to spend his summers in Newburyport, Massachusetts, the same place that Warner studied in the 1930s. He spent his summers there in the 50s and the 60s, maybe in the 70s, 20 years, and he saw changes, big changes going on in what was this traditional, old-fashioned New England town. And so he wrote about the parades and the quintessential symbolic elements that had been identified by Warner, and he showed that for instance, when he asked the banker, what class do you belong to? What did the banker say? Working class. How should you interpret working class in that answer? You could do a paper just on that. All of you could do a paper just on that answer. And, okay, so, all right, so I'm pointing to bigger paradigmatic changes, but building these changes without throwing everything else out, but consciously adding incrementally in the ways that Vildavsky did. So Vildavsky, as I mentioned, looked for some people to help him do this, to go beyond incrementalism, and he found Mary Douglas, top British anthropologist, social anthropologist, cultural anthropologist, who worked on contemporary societies, not just people in a small African tribe, and they did a book together called Risk and Culture, and basically what they brought in was the idea of culture and political culture as an underlying way of classifying these kinds of dimensions, and then saying which of these have more incremental or less incremental patterns of decision making, which have conflict, which have people in the street, which have people quietly, judiciously talking in a compromising way, the way they do, say, in Switzerland generally, versus the street demonstrations and battles versus murders and assassinations. All of these are part of politics in different parts of the world today, and sometimes they're in the same city. You've got different people who come from these different parts of the world and who say the way you do this is, you know, you kill your opponents. And so that there are battles over whose rules of the game should we follow, what's legitimate, what's not legitimate, and we're seeing this as well with Trump, with the judge, as Trump said, the so-called judge in Washington State, who said Trump is unconstitutional, throw Trump out, and so that this is a today's version of exactly the same kind of thing I'm suggesting has been going on for some time. Okay, so Vildavsky changed. Vildavsky learned and adapted what some pieces from anthropology in order to broaden the framework and the tools for analysis of political science, basically, and social science more generally. And he then probably wrote 20 more books about how he did it and why, and he's made videos and he's brilliantly articulate. And he's probably one of the most brilliant political scientists in the era and until recent times. And he lived right through in Oakland. He lived in Oakland himself, not Berkeley.
Okay.
I visited him many times there. He visited in Chicago with Mary Douglas, who was then teaching at Northwestern for a number of years, commenting on exactly these kinds of things. And one of them is what are the factors which lead to the changes? Violence is one thing we talked about, but where and why? And then the reactions against violence. The sense of shock, the use of the media, the sense that if there's a shock, there's often a self-questioning that maybe, I won't say, we don't have to say I'm right or wrong, but maybe one sector of the political system says, Trump for instance, maybe he's not completely right, whereas the judge is maybe he's not completely wrong, but that kind of challenge leads us as newspaper observers, social scientists, to try to say, what are they doing and why and how? And how much could we interpret, what are the two states that are joined in this lawsuit, Washington State and what's the other? Minnesota. What's the political culture of Washington State and Minnesota as you've read about it from Elazar? You were asked to give a name. You don't have to worry about the proper name, but you can ask. But what's the common theme between Washington State and Minnesota and something else that Elazar said pay attention to? Anybody? This is a footnote to the exam.
It's moralistic.
Exactly. Want to elaborate very briefly?
Longstanding morals that politicians tend to abide by. It's been more contemporary.
So in terms of the map, what joins Washington State with Minnesota with something else in terms of moralistic? You all should be able to answer this. Yeah.
Just like the New England Quaker tradition and the idea that like there are certain norms that you uphold and that type of participation is always to preserve that decorum.
Exactly right. Can we add one more piece which says how do we get from New England Quaker tradition to these particular states that Elazar talked about?
Manifest Destiny? Manifest Destiny?
Yeah. I'm asking a very simple question. Okay, but maybe it's too simple. The simple answer is, he said that is the driver which links with what's going on in Europe and the immigration discussion is, for Elazar, a major driver of change is migration. So if we have people from Syria or from Turkey or from Denmark who migrate to another city, another country, and they come together, we may well have the confrontation of the cultures of Turkey and Denmark in a new town in Washington State. And so similarly, there's the moralistic political culture of New England migrated west, and it's especially strong in the northmost parts of Michigan, Minnesota, Wisconsin, and so forth, as you get over to Washington State. In contrast to the Middle Atlantic, and in contrast to the Southern or the traditional. So each of these three types had people who migrated west, and that's what joins New England with Minnesota, with Washington State, with the moralistic style of the so-called judge, which Trump is fighting against, because he's not following usually that style of politics very much. He's not invoking moralism. He's not continually saying. Hillary Clinton did so, not always, but it was, again, I'm making a quick point. Notice that there's always a disparity between an abstract concept and any empirical manifestation. A state like Washington, a person like Trump, they're always a mixture. And so being able to go back and forth between the abstract concepts and say, well, you know, Trump is pretty much Middle Atlantic, individualistic, market, but he also has a bit of this and a bit of that, and then to show where and how he used those in a debate, for instance. Okay. So with Vildavsky, we have the transformation, we have the idea that the political culture is a roadmap. It's a roadmap, and it's a road that was traveled by these migrants within the U.S., but in his more important, longer works, LSR showed how this was global, international. The people from New England came from especially the ancient Jews with some of the ancient Greeks, and these migrating diaspora cultures combined and recombined with Christianity, with the Roman Catholic Church, and so forth, as we discussed. Okay, so this is going to still be going on. So one thing which I don't think has been done, but which could be done, say, for China, is to look at the migrations of types of culture inside China. And for instance, there are the port cities of Shanghai, where you have more international cosmopolitan patterns. There's the most inland mountainous areas where you have the more local. You then have, say, you had a highly sophisticated cosmopolitan court in a certain period, maybe hundreds of years ago, and then much of China and the court was taken over militarily by the tribes from the areas north of there, and they brought in a more military, hierarchical, tough style of leadership, which transformed national Chinese patterns in ways that we have each of these in various forms, which you can see coming down through literature, through painting, and of course more general history and politics. Okay, so all right. So here's briefly the LSR combined with Vildavsky applied to budgeting and incrementalism transformations idea. Let me mention some big changes that went on in especially Western Europe, U.S., China, in roughly the late 60s and early 70s, and how these still, let's ask, how do these continue today, either literally or in analogous patterns? And so let me just mention these briefly. And then, and these are global and international, but how do they work out at the local level? Another way is to look at big patterns internationally and then say, okay, Chicago's more like this, whereas Seattle is more like that. So, one big thing fits with this, and the idea, if this is sort of class, we can then have culture, political culture, and party programs. Okay, one simple idea from the past was the political right and the political left differ, and this is a continuum that goes from conservative to liberal, and that the rich people vote right and the poor people vote left. Okay, that you have, that's a 19th century theory in much of Europe. It's the core idea of the New Deal in the US from FDR onward, 1933. The question is, does this still hold? Okay, and the answer in Washington and in Paris and in London for some people is yes, this is still real politics. And anything else is false consciousness. Okay, there are many smart political scientists who still say this, such as, actually he's a statistician, joint appointment in political science at Columbia, Gelman, G-E-L-L-M-A-N, a very smart guy, has a book called Left, Right, Blue, Red, States. And so he compares the states in the U.S. and how they vote, and his basic analysis is income, that rich people should vote Republican and poor people should vote Democrat. Simple idea. He knows it's too simple, but he doesn't really elaborate an alternative. there are internationally, okay, there Lipset's chapter on democracy and the income basis of democracy is the same basic idea. So if this is a classic sort of 19th century, this classic left-right idea, this is being transformed. And the one way we talked about is the new political culture adding social issues, but we threw in others such as from Vildowski and Douglas. They have four types that I briefly mentioned, and which are in the readings, let me briefly introduce then where and why these might change. Okay, that is to think about the transformation process as a separate kind of historic period or mechanism which leads to transformation of the theories. But the mechanism in its own right is important to pay attention to. So what are three or four of these that are historically important for US and Europe? Arguably, one of the most important was, okay, so if we have the New Deal, we have the left and right here, how did this change? One big thing was the civil rights movement in the U.S., Martin Luther King. The mobilization was not based on income, it was based on race, on racial discrimination, and it was started in the South. Two, it innovated in its tactics. It did not just say vote, because blacks could not vote in the American South. Second, it used the media. Television was new and it had power and it could take things to people's homes. It had elements of moralism where you could appeal and say, look how this racism of bad places is hurting people in ways that should be considered immoral by all Americans and by everyone in the world. And so Martin Luther King, rather than waiting for the media to choose an extreme case of violence, he and others of his leadership team would find, you know, here's a really nasty police chief, and he's in a town called Selma, Let's go to Selma and have a little demonstration and see what he does. And so they went there, and he played his part perfectly. And it was on national television, and citizens were outraged. And they said, we support Martin Luther King. This is a violent, okay. Came to Chicago, he went to, did he go to the Lincoln Park, where people would have said, yes, we welcome blacks here, no forth, no problem, and so forth. No, he went to Cicero. Cicero, people threw beer cans. They said, get out of here, you nasty blacks, you don't belong here. It's a, you know, get out. And that was on national television. That was just what King wanted. Okay, so the point is, that style of the civil rights movement and tactics, adding a new set of issues, mobilization, new themes, but joining them with, what have you heard about in the scenes dimensions? Egalitarianism. If you treat people differently based on their racial background, and they don't have a reasonable reason for doing so, you're simply discriminating. And so the norm of egalitarianism and the social science concept of egalitarianism can be used to interpret how Martin Luther King would use this consciously as a tactic, and how this in turn leads to potentially the transformation of the concepts used to analyze left and right. So, Birmingham, Alabama, Bull Connor, cattle prods. The leader of a lot of this in Alabama was Dorothy Tillman. She left school. Where we go? Here we go. Got a quote from her. Just got a little bit. Wish I don't have a. We interviewed her and just we had an audio. I wish we'd had a video because anyway we'll try to get you a little more on Dorothy. But glance at her sometime on YouTube or other places. Listen to her now, alderman. She was alderman in. Just north of here, ward just north of here. Harold Washington's old third ward. She and another King co-worker, Jesse Jackson, helped mobilize black support against mayors Daley and Byrne and eventually persuaded U.S. Congressman Harold Washington to run for mayor. How did they mobilize? Her answer, in the same way and with many of the same people as under Martin Luther King. Find a hierarchical opponent, demonstrate against it, try to force the hierarchy to use violence to stop your demonstration. Supporters will then rally to you. That's the simple idea. Quote, that's what they call me, the movement baby, I guess because I'm from Montgomery and grew up with the civil rights struggle and I've been involved all my life. How'd you get up here? The headquarters called me to go on the Northern tour, to go with Dr. King on the Northern tour. So they picked their best, modest. I was always like an advanced person, you know, to go ahead. We toured the whole North to decide which city we were going to work in, and I didn't like it. But the consensus about coming to Chicago was that if we could crack Chicago, we could crack the world, that it would all go across. Because Daley was so tough, the Democratic Party was so strong and hierarchical, if we can crack them, we can do anything. And Richard Daley said to us, you won't win here. The way you won in the South was they beat your heads. We're going to make sure they don't touch you here. And that's what he did. I mean, he was smart now. Okay, the converse of the hierarchy principle is that as hierarchy declines, it's harder to mobilize against us, against it. Okay, so taking quotes, taking individual concrete changes, and then joining them with the more general concepts, as you've seen us do. Second big event I'm now saying transformations, and many of these come from the period from the late 60s to early 70s. I'm going to run through just four. Civil rights movement first. Second, the Vietnam War was a huge budget drain as well as the drain on the political legitimacy of the political leadership in the U.S. It had earlier been in France. Think of Afghanistan, think of Iraq. These are very similar kinds of situations which challenge the past, the past schisms. Think of Tiananmen Square in China. Third, students on campuses mobilized against the Vietnam War and developed a style that continued traditional union organizing, combined with the civil rights demonstrations, bullhorns, sit-ins, large crowds, militant and moralistic speakers, confrontations with someone to invoke the hierarchy and force them to repress you. Washington and Vietnam were too far away, so campus authorities were attacked as repressive. So choose a local symbol, even if you can't get all the way to Vietnam or Washington. Fourth, unionization of public sector employees was occurring in cities in the U.S. at the same time. That is, public sector employees had been legally and traditionally non-unionized. It was said, you know, you don't have the right, it's civil servants, government staff serve the people. It is incompatible with that public good that you may join a union. That was the view in the 40s, 50s, 60s, and so forth. That changed in this era. So the unions were saying government workers have rights like all other workers and they should be able to unionize. So they were demonstrating outside City Hall, back and forth, walking with their signs saying unionize, unionize, at the same time that you had anti-Vietnam protesters, peace in Vietnam, and you had student protesters, down with the president of Northwestern, and so forth. What happened at Berkeley over the weekend? Same kind of thing. Almost maybe three or four days ago, whatever, with a speaker. So the combinations of these themes led to a sense of, that is, a black political mobilization, Vietnam, campus radicalism, and public sector unionization. They all shared themes and borrowed tactics from one another. They occurred simultaneously with big cities or centers of action. They all portrayed themselves as fighting for democracy against hierarchical suppressors, and they all succeeded and failed. The drama of their success was often unrecognized since their rhetoric and ambitious goals often presented as so-called unnegotiable demands were seldom fully met. But compared to what there was before, they brought dramatic change in each of their respective areas. They all built in turn on deeper changes, the larger size of the black population in northern cities, the increasing education of the general population, the expansion of higher education and government programs, an economy of almost continuous growth since World War II, and we'll systematize these, and it's done in the various readings. And these in turn led to uncertainty as to what should be the models for interpreting how things get done. And so just let me mention, without going into the specifics, that the City Money book, and especially chapter 4, goes into ways of saying, showing how you can build a model like this with multiple sources and then some intervening links like unions, interest groups, political parties, and how those in turn work. And then I've talked about context one, context two. Another way to do this is historical period one, historical period two. And so that's the way we do it with the data we have in the book, because we have the same cities over time, and we show three big historical periods. The mid-60s, the late 60s and 70s, then after 1974. And the point, the bigger point, is these coefficients, A, B, C, D, E, shifted systematically in different historic periods. Roughly, you have citizens as drivers more strong in the mid-60s. In the late 60s and 70s, you had organized groups, unions, political parties, civil rights movements, and stronger mayors that were acting in ways in this time of uncertainty, and they did have an. These are based on national U.S. urban comparisons of, this was 62, mostly 62 cities in the City Money book. And then after 1974, most of these factors I've just listed, unions, leaders, civil rights groups, lost their nationally significant impact. And citizens came back as a taxpayers' revolt. Many people who've looked at this kind of thing would say, hey, that's Trump. This is populism. We call these people initially, these leaders, new fiscal populists. They were fiscally conservative, and they were populist in their appeal. And that's what Trump is doing. He's just going further, and he's not doing it in a, I mean, he's different from them. He comes from the right rather than from the left traditionally. He's joined with a political party, the Republican political party, rather than an independent Democratic Party, which was more often the case, say, with Blair and Clinton. But the point of the populist element, the mobilization of citizens is a continually transforming force, which is also going on in China. You've got the CCP, very important still, but it's responding more and more to citizens, because the citizens are getting more and more important in China. The economy is responding to citizens. You have Starbucks in China. You have dog walkers in China. Citizens are, these are new, these are not part of the CCP traditionally. They're not from Marx. So how to deal with these citizen-driven transformations is unclear. And so that's how and why we need to use these kinds of concepts to say how do we deal with these sorts of changes. And so I'm pointing to citizen mobilization, new leaders, we call them new fiscal populists, or then later on the new political culture, new leaders who tried to capture these citizen preferences that they saw as changing and then throw out ways of doing so in policies, and many of them were then elected. And the general point, the brilliance of focus, the urban focus in this course, is that by looking at more extreme examples and by looking at variations of these combinations of types of leaders, types of programs, types of parties, you can disentangle the party from the poverty, from the unemployment, from the race, from the specific ethnic group, and so forth, and say, how important is one of these when we control each of the others? And so statistically we can do multivariate analysis, like multiple regression. That is, we can see how important these are by comparing either quantitatively in that way or qualitatively, the way the New York Times and Wall Street Journal. They go to one town in North Carolina, the furniture industry has collapsed, and they say, they have quotes with people say, yes, I lost my job, I don't know what I'm doing in life. Who are you going to vote for? Trump. Okay. So in that sense, telling a story of that sort with one case is analogous to trying to say, you know, how that is using, that is the brilliance of that case, is you're choosing an outlier. So the media do it and they feature the one extreme case. What social scientists can do is have both the outliers on many of these different variables simultaneously, positive and negative, as well as places that are in the middle. We can call those a scatter plot. So if we plot two variables here, like Trump voting and income, or Trump voting and unemployment, or Trump voting and African American, and so forth, we can put these individual counties or individual zip codes on here. Then we can look at a regression line. But then we can choose outliers, places that are not on the regression line, places that deviate from the national pattern, and as well as places that are on the national pattern. And but if we do both of these at the same time, that is, we have the national picture in front of us, ideally, and we've assembled all these data. We got 10,000 cities around the world. We can say, what's the national pattern in China, in France, in the U.S., and then how does Gary fit with that? And so that's why we have in the case study of Gary in the City Money book, we show that Gary, in many respects, was high on percent African American, but it was much lower on spending. Why did they spend so much less in Gary than they did in Detroit, for instance? So you can look at, you can do a case study, and we have an actual scatter plot like this in the City Money chapter, which discusses the Gary case in ways that illustrate that further. Okay. Let me stop here for now. As I've talked about Vildowski, I've given you a hint of Clark and Ferguson, but let's have a little discussion, and I can bring in the other readings if depending on what your reactions are. What do you think about any of, we talked about a lot of issues so far today. Any ways of applying some of this to a city you know like Oakland, let me ask you one question. Can two of you tell us any memories or stories you have heard from your parents or your grandparents about what they were doing in 1968? Roughly 19, let's say 67, 68, 69, 70. What's come down to you from your own personal experience? Either anecdotes they've told you or things that may have combined with documentaries or movies or things you've heard. And how did that change them and change you because of what happened then? Just as you're looking at, if we think of the Trump election in this period now, flash forward 20 years from now, how will you, your children, or you know, people 20, 30 years from now, think differently because of what has happened in these months? So, who has a story about let's say more generally, the counterculture, the rise of the counterculture after 68? Woodstock, Berkeley, Columbia, these were all headlines the way Trump is right now. Is this ancient history? Nobody has any? You have nothing? I bet you got a lot of stories if you rumble around the back of your heads. I'll tell one. A student in this classroom said, yes, my parents met at Berkeley in 1968. My mother was a student there, and my father was a National Guardsman. He was holding back the crowds and trying to be calm, and she came up to him and spat in his face. They were so shocked, but somehow attracted, that they married, and I was their son.
I wonder how that happened.
Anybody have a story? Maybe you can't top that, but how about something that's... yes.
This isn't as exciting, and it was way before 68, but it speaks more to the spectrum of, like, very much class-based hard party lines that are very also, like, grounded in identity. My grandfather was a Ukrainian immigrant who grew up and was first in his family to go to college at University of Maryland, where he was president of the UDems, and he ushered at Kennedy's inauguration because of that. And so that's like the story that's been handed down through my family.
So he did what at Kennedy's
inauguration? Oh, he was an usher at Kennedy's inauguration.
Okay.
In his capacity as like a student Democrat leader. But he comes from like hard labor, the industrial base of Maryland, and the idea that, you know, America's a meritocracy, a meritocratic place, but also wonder if you grew up working, you're always going to be a Democrat for life.
Okay.
I think that's probably in the DNA of my family. So
does he still agree with that?
He does. It's weird because he is like much more on like the capitalist end now because he's a business owner and he's like fairly prosperous, but he's still kind of like an old time party hardliner and. Like,
he still votes Democrat.
He does, and he like watches. He used to watch MSNBC religiously, but after the election, he's like gone into a little bit of a depression where he can't even watch it anymore.
Okay. Good. Powerful story. That's great. I mean, that in a sense, it's the power of this left-right classification, and then the sense that something is wrong. He can't watch it anymore because it doesn't fit his cognitive map. That illustrates what Lipp said and Lazarsfeld talk about, that it's called cross pressure. I mean, if you have a sense that this is how the world should work, and then you see things that don't fit, if you have two things that are pressuring you in two different ways, many people try to stay away from deciding, or they don't do it, or they don't go to that bar again, to avoid the sense of cross pressure. So that means, so it's a great example, but it's generalizable in showing the disjuncture between what we have in our heads and what we experienced in the past and present. Okay. Anybody else? Antoine.
Yeah, 1969, my old man. My father was went to high school in Queens in New York City to train to be a carpenter. And the training was kind of off-site from the high school, so there was this master's hill. And my dad went to school at the top of the hill for general classes. At the bottom of the hill was the place where work, where shop was. Vietnam War was going on. My dad, since he was in a trade job, he was given automatic deferment. That's where a lot of people back then. But the school had banned boots. You know, if you work in a shop, that you know, you don't wear sneakers to shop. You chop your toes off. You wear boots. So my dad had Carhartt boots, regular work boots. You see linemen wear those kind of people. You ever see somebody work on your house? So it snowed one year, and of course the school still banned boots. But my dad had to lug his toolbox and all kinds of other stuff up and down this hill to go to his workshop classes, and then back up the hill to go back to academic classes. So he just didn't bother to change his shoes one day, and went and walked into the high school, wiped his boots off, and walked on into class. And the teacher freaked out, swore that he was starting a Black Panther type of protest movement, threw him out of class. Now, mind you, my dad was the top student in his class for carpentry, had top remarks from all his professors, and didn't have any disrespect. My dad was just, I have to go back and forth up this hill. There's snow outside. We got bad enough we have to carry our own toolbox because there's no lockers. And he just was not going to be bothered anymore. So this story leaked out. And the next day, everybody in that trade program wore their boots from the trade school at the bottom of the hill, back up the hill, and walked through the high school. And they kept doing this week after week. And eventually, the principal and administrator, they didn't punish my dad and kind of threw the citations out against the other students that they had cited. So in my dad's yearbook, it's next to his photo, it says, "These boots were made for walking." Because the people, everyone in high school really supported my dad, because back then the schools were, New York City schools were still a bit more integrated in that regard. So the white students were a bit more forward-minded than that kind of like the stuff you see now. But even the people who kind of were just trying to work their way through the Vietnam War, literally the kind of mind your own business, and there are a lot of black folks that where that was a thing. You know, you go get your education, you stay out of the trouble, you leave the fighting for those folks, you get your education. My dad was the oldest of eight, and he had mouths to feed at home, basically, because he was a breadwinner for the large family at the time. So my dad was just trying to make ends meet and trying to do it, you know, trying to get through. So, you know, that was one side of that, where just doing something innocuous, is trying to walk in the snow, to go to class, to do the right thing in terms of getting the education, could make you a radical or somebody who's out to get the protest vote. Many moons later, I was going to a private school, this is in the 90s, a place called Friends Academy in Long Island, Gold Coast, Long Island. And I had to get a neurological exam, so I was ordered to shave my head to go in for this exam, so I was bald. Then I had to go back to school. And I got pulled out of class for having a bald head, because someone in the administration thought that I was going to start an uprising in this private school, and the same thing, this Black Panther-esque kind of bullshit, and that's exactly what it is. So I get this citation, I go home to my mom, like, they're mad at me because my head is bald. And there was other people of color. This is the kind of thing, if you're a black man, either your hair's going to grow out like this or you're going to shave it down really low. In this case, I shaved it bald, but I had no political statement. I wasn't starting any trouble. So I told my mother, now mind you, we're paying a fortune to this private school. So my mother flips out, calls up all the black people at the school, so all 10 of us. Hand to God, all 10 of us. calls them all up and sees what's going on. There were other students who were getting in trouble because there used to be this haircut called the undershave that was popular amongst people with long hair where you shave the sides and let the top flop over. So that was popular and that was in trouble. So all of us who got in haircut problems, white and black, stormed school at the same time from 7th and 8th grades because the way the school was split. We all stormed the school at the same time and holding photos of, how can you tell which kid his haircut is this? How come this white boy has this haircut and my kid has a haircut that's low? He's not up there protesting. You know, the whole point of being a Black Panther is doing one of these things and interrupting class, and none of us were doing that, and the school had no response. Because the basic way that the hair policies were written were distinctly biased against people of color vis-a-vis those folks who are white. So even now, like going into the 90s, and this stuff still repeats itself, you know, these kind of fear symbols of protest from bygone eras is still kind of percolate themselves. And so it's not ancient history. So that's why I had to laugh. It's not ancient history at all. Because to this day, this stuff will happen. Especially if you have a child who's mixed or a child of color. This stuff will happen. It'll keep happening for some time to come. The stuff with Trump is probably going to exacerbate a lot of those. So those are my stories. Stories are tied together.
Those are two wonderful stories, and that they show the disjuncture between the big ideological Black Panthers label and the very specific lifestyle, trying to, you know, walk up and down the hill, not waste your time carrying extra shoes and so forth with the tools, and then as well as the haircut. So, cheers. That's great. Any other themes of how to pull some of my remarks together, or questions on interpretation or problems of what either what you've read and or what I've said and you've heard today? Yes.
Yes, I just want to ask a question. I have learned that for Chicago, especially the Black community, it says that because many women just take part in the civil rights, civil activities in the 1960s. So in 1980s, and they can combine with together in the slums community, and they can help each other, because some children and women, if they have some problems, the workers in hospital and the policemen can come as quickly as possible. But 20 years later, for now, because these people who have taken part in the civil rights have get older and older, I don't know in these lower class communities, is there still some informal organizations just like this? And another question is that it said that I don't really understand the Taylor plan, public housing, Taylor plan. It says that it just make the lower class live together, and so it will influence they move to a higher class. And maybe in 1994, there is another public housing plan, just called Legends Lost, I don't know. But I learned that it just wanted to the lower class people to live with the upper class people. But I don't know the influence of this public housing plan. So can you introduce something about it?
Okay, I'll focus more on I'm trying to do the more general to link with more of you rather than too specifically on public housing. The bigger excellent question you raised is where and why do these groups get created and how do they persist or get transformed? So I talked about the civil rights movement as an example. And this I heard even just on an NPR discussion yesterday in Romania. Romania had the largest demonstration. They had thousands, hundreds of thousands of people came out because the political leaders, prime minister, the minister of justice, and so forth, had a new law which they actually implemented, which said anyone accused of corruption, patronage, bribery, cannot be prosecuted beyond a certain period of time or something like that. That is, it began to exempt people from corruption charges. All right, the citizens of Romania said, no! So they came out in massive numbers, and basically the prime minister said, we were mistaken, we won't do that. So then this led to discussion, where and why Romania and not other places? And so there's a little discussion that, for instance, Hungary has a very weak civil organizational pattern. Romania has a very active set of civic groups which are much more present, and this is bowling alone kind of stuff. That is, where and why do you, Tocqueville, where do you get these different kinds of organized groups? And what is their residue? One of the things we found when I put on the board, and it's in the Scenescapes book, and it's in the Kentuckville Karaoke book, this rise in the number of arts and culture organizations and the decline in most other organizations. The exception is the former Soviet areas, Eastern Europe, Russia, and China, all have declines in the arts, in contrast to Scandinavia, Korea, Canada, US, Australia, where the arts are taking off. What's different in the former Soviet areas, and what, and then within these specific areas? There was a woman in an earlier class who was from Romania, and so she did a paper on Romania and Russia, and she basically interpreted, she read a lot of literature on these different countries, and her interesting result was basically, it depends on the specific organization. That is, some of the organizations, and this is how we can link to Chicago and then other places, some of the organizations were what in Chicago we would call standard or established organizations that were officially, explicitly linked with the Democratic Party. Others were called independent, and that label independent meant independent of the regular Democratic Party in Chicago. So you can see that these labels are not uniquely Chicagoan, they're especially relevant and applicable to strong party states like China or Hungary or Romania. And so the point was, in the strongest party days, Stalin, etc., you had many organizations, singing organizations, unions, militias, I mean, all kinds of organizations that were linked with the party, and they would extend the political party. Same thing in France. I mean, the Socialist Party had local groups that they would fund, and they would give, when they came to office, they'd give lots more money to singing organizations, to unions, to housewives, to cooking organizations that were specifically linked with that political party, and then people remembered that on election day. Okay, with the rise of more education, more independence, more citizens saying, I don't want to just follow the rules, I want to be more independent, these organizations lost their legitimacy, especially again after first 68 and then 1989. So with the collapse of communism in Russia and in Eastern Europe, the communist-linked organizations lost their legitimacy. But which organizations? Okay, so the older people in Romania and Hungary and so forth lost the places that they would go to sing or to do sports or other kinds of things. So the younger people then formed new organizations that were not linked with the corrupt old past, and they then started new kinds of activities, but the net effect of these were still so small and so few that they were swamped by the decline of the traditional organizations, leading to the overall pattern of declining civic engagement in these countries in these years. There are activists in Eastern Europe, as in the West, fighting hard to try to improve the independence, the activism, the autonomy of civic organizations to make the world more Tocquevillian. France is a dramatic case where we contrast these organizations in the chapter in the book on Kent Tocqueville Karaoke, but it's the same sort of pattern within Chicago, where you had the model. Or sorry, let me illustrate it just once more with Gary versus Detroit. The mayor of Detroit was Coleman Young, who worked with the traditional Democratic Party, and he was head of the union, the strong automobile workers union, and he followed as a union man union policies of increasing wages for workers for the city of Detroit. The mayor of Gary, Richard Hatcher, did the opposite. He came from the civil rights organizations of Martin Luther King, SCLC, etc. And the style there was not to have a small number of highly paid government workers, but a large number of people who would vote for you, who would demonstrate, who would come out in larger numbers. So he said, we don't want high wages for a few, we want low wages for large numbers of municipal employees. So he would break up a job, instead of saying, here's one job, we're gonna hire one worker, we'd break it up into five jobs and say, we'll hire five people and we'll each let them work different parts of the day and we'll reduce unemployment, we'll at least get them involved and we'll get the political benefit of helping them because they're working for the city and working for me and I gave them the job. Okay, so that these were both nationally very important models of African American mayors in the 1970s, doing the opposite policies. So I'm simply throwing in that we can look at the context, we can say biographically they're different, as we did say with Antoine. But what then Antoine's stories nicely showed how people were ironically, humorously misapplying an ideological cultural frame that created a disjuncture that had unanticipated consequences in the cases which he illustrated, which match up here as well. Okay, let's stop today. We can continue with office hours right here and talk further, but thank you. And let's look for ideas. That is, how about look for something for you to think about that you might propose. Maybe three of you might give us some presentations with some ideas. Others think about little projects that you might do, and then we'll propose.
Hi, I'm Ben Picker. I just wanted to talk to you briefly about the analysis that I'm doing.
Sure.
The paper that I'm working on.
Great.
The basic structure of what I've done is I've talked to Antoine about my data, and the data that I've collected are the tweets between January 20th, 2016 and January 20th, 2017.
Okay. So can you show me how to log in and do that for him?
And I've done, he's asked me that.